Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Prophetic Lament, A Call for Justice in Troubled Times by Soong-Chan Rah. Foreword by Brenda Salter McNeil. Narrated by Soong-Chan Rah. Foreword by Brenda Salter McNeil. The church has lost its ability to lament. This heartfelt cry came from a seminary student as she prayed with other graduate students, faculty, and staff, who gathered together to seek God for racial justice and reconciliation throughout our nation. As we cried and prayed together, we realized that our theology and spiritual formation hadn't given us sufficient permission, language, or tools to adequately sit with the despair and sadness of recent racial injustices, senseless acts of gun violence, and social unrest taking place in the world around us. We even saw this in social media, where people also seem paralyzed and helpless to know what to do and how to respond. Sincere, well-meaning Christian people asked, "What should we do?" While people who were fed up with the seeming indifference of those around them expressed their outrage through a hashtag that proclaimed, "Silence is violence." All of this reminded me of when my brother and friend Soong-Chan Rah asked me to write the foreword to this book. His request came when we were both in Ferguson, Missouri, with 30 to 40 other evangelical leaders for a faith roundtable to strategize how the Christian church should respond to the social unrest and the rising civil rights movement emerging from the shooting death of an unarmed black teenager by a white police officer. We gathered together to learn and to envision the ways that we might guide the church and the country in the process of healing and reconciliation. On the last day of our gathering, we received the shockingly disturbing news that police officers who strangled and killed an African-American man on video while he repeatedly cried, "I can't breathe," would not be indicted. One young black man in our meeting took this news exceptionally hard and had to be taken out of the room as he wept aloud. One of the elder stateswomen in the group quickly called for us to sing a song of lament. In response, a black female worship leader began to lead us in an upbeat chorus about taking back what the devil had stolen from us and placing him under our feet. As I stood near a black male colleague from another theological seminary, we held hands and remained silent. Then he leaned down and whispered in my ear in a concerned voice, "I feel very uncomfortable with this. What does this have to do with lament?" Of course, he was right. Even though many of us had been nurtured in the rich tradition of the African-American church that taught us to sing songs like, "Nobody knows the trouble I've seen," "I must tell Jesus," "Precious Lord, take my hand," and "Sometimes I feel like a motherless child," somehow, we had also lost our historic and spiritual legacy of being able to corporately lament. It is situations like these that remind me of why all of us desperately need the strategic and prophetic book. From start to finish, it offers us the theological tools and practical insights to develop a prophetic imagination that envisions and advocates for the world as God intended it to be. In my opinion, there is no one who is better equipped to help us engage in this important work than Soong-Chan Rah. I have worked with, served alongside, and learned from his wise and academically rich teaching on numerous occasions. In all these capacities, he is profoundly brilliant, intellectually insightful, spiritually inspiring, and socially relevant. Dr. Rah is one of the leading evangelical voices in the world today. He is also humbly and consistently living out the values he espouses in his personal life with his family and friends and through his professional pursuits. He embodies the type of leadership I call emerging Christian reconcilers to emulate as I speak and consult about the issue of racial reconciliation around the world. Soong-Chan Rah knows that these emerging leaders are just like the young woman in our prayer meeting crying out to God for new language and skills to lament the complex social justice issues that they face. This book is an answer to that prayer and offers all of us a better way forward. Series Introduction. We live in an increasingly biblically illiterate culture, not simply in terms of knowing what the Bible says, but also in knowing how God wants to use His Word to draw us closer to Him. The contemporary situation has drawn greater attention to the need for biblical and theological reflection that is culturally engaging. Yet the need isn't new. In every age and in every region of the world, the church needs to be concerned for the biblical sense. What does this particular book of the Bible mean? And its cultural significance? What does it have to say to us in our particular setting? Never confusing the two, but always relating them. Only then can our reflections resonate well both with Scripture and with people's life situations. As you can imagine, it's a daunting challenge. This is the challenge I face daily in my work as a professor at Multnomah Biblical Seminary in Portland, Oregon, and as a director of its Institute for the Theology of Culture, New Wine, New Wineskins, new-wineskins.org. Many of my students do not come from Christian homes and have never been exposed to Scripture in a meaningful way, but they often come well-equipped to engage pop culture. Other students have been long entrenched in the Christian subculture and struggle to engage meaningfully in a pluralistic context that does not recognize the Bible as truthful and authoritative for life. Thankfully, Portland is a wonderful living laboratory in which to prepare for ministry within an increasingly diverse setting. Ministry that brings the Bible to bear on that context in a theologically sound and grace-filled manner. The aim of the Resonate series is to provide spiritual nourishment that is biblically sound, theologically orthodox, and culturally significant. The form each volume in the series will take is that of an extended essay. Each author writing about a biblical book in an interactive, reflective, and culturally engaging manner. Why this approach? There are scores of commentaries on the market from biblical scholars who go verse by verse through the biblical text. While these works are extremely important, there is an increasingly urgent need for pastors who feel at home in the biblical text to bring that text home to today's Christ followers. They do this by interacting with the text expositionally, placing it within the context of contemporary daily life, and viewing their personal stories in light of the original context and unfolding drama of ancient Scripture. There is also a need for people who feel at home in contemporary culture, but who are foreigners to Scripture, to inhabit the world of the Bible without abandoning their own context. God would have us live in both worlds. Speaking of context, it is worth noting how this series emerged. I was participating at a consultation on the future of theological inquiry at the Center of Theological Inquiry in Princeton, New Jersey, when David Sanford, former managing editor of the series, contacted me to ask if I would serve as executive editor for Resonate. His timing could not have been better. During the consultation in Princeton, we discussed the need for academics to be more intentional about writing to popular culture and not focus exclusively on writing to our peers in the scholarly guild. We also discussed how greater efforts needed to be made to bridge the academy and the church. In addition to dialoguing with David Sanford and sketching out what I would envision for such a series, I spoke with several biblical scholars during the consultation. One went so far as to tell me there was no need for another commentary series, for there was an overabundance of them on the market. But when they heard the vision for Resonate, they encouraged me to move forward with it. Like them, I believe a series of this kind could go a long way toward encouraging and equipping today's pastors and teachers to engage each book of the Bible in a thoughtful and rigorous manner. Some volumes in this series are written by thoughtful practitioners and others by practically oriented academics. Whether practitioner or academic, each author approaches the subject matter not from the standpoint of detached observer, but rather as a fully engaged participant in the text. Always working with the community of editors I have assembled for the series, along with the editorial team at InterVarsity Press. Instead of proceeding verse by verse, The author of each Resonate volume draws insights from the featured book's major themes, all the while attentive to the context in which these themes are developed. The author's purposes are to guide, guard, and grow listeners as they move forward in their own spiritual journeys. In addition to focusing on the major themes of the book under consideration, each author also locates that particular book within the context of the triune God's overarching narrative of holy love for Israel, church, and world. Our aim with this distinctive new genre is to have one finger in the ancient scriptures, another in the daily newspaper, and another touching the heart, all the while pointing to Jesus Christ. This is no easy task, of course, but when accomplished, it is extremely rewarding. Each contributor to Resonate seeks to bear witness to Jesus Christ, the living Word of God, through the written Word in and through his or her own life story and the broader cultural context. So often we go around Scripture to Jesus, or we stop short at Scripture and fail to penetrate it to get to Jesus' heart, which is the Father's heart too. Instead, each of us needs to depend on God's Spirit to discern how our culturally situated words and stories are included in the biblical meta-narrative, and to learn how to bring God's Word home to our hearts and lives in a truthful and meaningful manner. We trust that you will find this and other Resonate volumes beneficial as you exegete Scripture and culture in service to Jesus Christ, church, and world, and as God exegetes your heart through His Word and Spirit. With this in mind, we dedicate this series as a whole to you as you embark on this arduous and incredible journey. Paul Lewis Metzger, PhD, Executive Editor, Resonate. Introduction. A Call to Lament. In the summer of 1996, my wife and I led a church planting effort in inner city Cambridge, Massachusetts. Cambridge, which twins the larger sister city of Boston, hosts two world-class universities, Harvard University and the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Central Square, the neighborhood sandwiched between Harvard and MIT, serves as the locus of civic life in Cambridge. The university students refer to Central Square as Central Scare. It is the scary urban neighborhood into which you dare not venture. But our church deliberately chose this location. We planted our church with the hope of launching outreach to our inner city neighborhood and fostering an intentionally multi-ethnic church community. The church initially drew its membership from the colleges and universities in close proximity to the church. The students that came to our church were recipients of educational opportunities unavailable to most of the world's population. Members were attracted to the urban vision of the church, but were not necessarily city-raised or city-wise individuals. Many were coming to the church to learn about urban ministry and life in the city. So while the urban vision of the church was an attraction, most of the church members had little to no roots in the city. Part of our church vision reflected the desire to motivate young, educated individuals to connect with the city and find ways to engage in urban ministry. Our newly formed community struggled with the central question of how an affluent and privileged community would intersect with the poor in the Central Scare neighborhood. As we geared up to conduct our first public service in September, I grappled with which sermon series would be an appropriate introduction to this fledgling church. The Gospel of Mark seemed like a natural choice since the story of Jesus should be the center of the Christian community. Maybe a nice Pauline letter like Romans would provide the opportunity to teach a systematic theological structure for a young congregation. I even considered preaching on the book of Revelation and the story of God's plan for the heavenly city. But after the requisite initial round of opening services, my first full sermon series for the new church plant was a 6-week exposition on the Book of Lamentations, a seemingly illogical choice being both from the Old Testament and a downer of a book. It was not a typical sermon series for a new church plant. Church growth books would not advocate for 6 weeks of lamenting as a way to spark interest in a new church. There's not a whole lot of user-friendliness or seeker sensitivity in what some consider a rather depressing book in the biblical canon. Years later, I recognize God's providence in directing me toward Lamentations. The triumph and success orientation of our typical church member needed the corrective brought by stories of struggle and suffering. These stories should not merely provide a sprinkling of flavor for the existing triumphalistic narrative that furthers the privilege of those in the dominant culture. The tendency to view the holistic work of the church as the action of the privileged toward the marginalized often derails the work of true community healing. Ministry in the urban context, acts of justice and racial reconciliation, require a deeper engagement with the other, an engagement that acknowledges suffering rather than glossing over it. Theologian Randy Woodley identifies this deeper engagement as the Hebrew word shalom, which is often translated simplistically as peace. Woodley asserts that shalom is active and engaged, going far beyond the mere absence of conflict. A fuller understanding of shalom is the key to the door that can lead us to a whole new way of living in the world. Shalom combats the dualism rampant in Western culture and is instead rooted in a more Hebraic passion for equilibrium, a sense of system in which all the parts cohere. Shalom, therefore, does not eschew or diminish the role of the other or the reality of a suffering world. Instead, it embraces the suffering other as an instrumental aspect of well-being. Shalom requires lament. The Old Testament is composed of many different genres, including poetry. Within the genre of poetry exist many subgenres. Old Testament scholar Klaus Westermann situates the Hebrew poetic material into two broad categories, praise and lament. Westermann asserts that as the two poles, they determine the nature of all speaking to God. Psalms that express worship for the good things that God has done are categorized as praise hymns. Laments are prayers of petition arising out of need. But lament is not simply the presentation of a list of complaints, nor merely the expression of sadness over difficult circumstances. Lament in the Bible is a liturgical response to the reality of suffering and engages God in the context of pain and trouble. The hope of lament is that God would respond to human suffering that is wholeheartedly communicated through lament. Unfortunately, lament is often missing from the narrative of the American church. In Journey Through the Psalms, Denise Hopkins examines the use of lament in the major liturgical denominations in America. The study found that in the Lutheran Book of Worship, the Episcopalian Book of Common Prayer, the Catholic Lectionary for Mass, the Hymnal of the United Church of Christ, and the United Methodist Hymnal, the majority of psalms omitted from liturgical use are the laments. This trend is found not only in the mainline traditions, but in less liturgical traditions as well. In Hurting with God, Glenn Pemberton notes that lament constitutes 40% of all psalms, but only 13% of the hymnal for the Churches of Christ, 19% of the Presbyterian hymnal, and 13% of the Baptist hymnal. Christian Copyright Licensing International, CCLI, licenses local churches in the use of contemporary worship songs and tracks the songs that are most frequently sung in local churches. CCLI's list of the top 100 worship songs in August of 2012, reveals that only 5 of those songs would qualify as a lament. Most of the songs reflect themes of praise. How great is our God! Here I am to worship. Happy day. Indescribable. Friend of God. Glorious day. Marvelous light. And victory in Jesus. The American church avoids lament. The power of lament is minimized, and the underlying narrative of suffering that requires lament is lost. But absence does not make the heart grow fonder. Absence makes the heart forget. The absence of lament in the liturgy of the American church results in the loss of memory. We forget the necessity of lamenting over suffering and pain. We forget the reality of suffering and pain. In his book Peace, Walter Brueggemann writes about this contrast between a theology of the have-nots versus a theology of the haves. The have-nots develop a theology of suffering and survival. The haves develop a theology of celebration. Those who live under suffering live their lives aware of the acute precariousness of their situation. Worship that arises out of suffering cries out for deliverance. Their notion of themselves is that of a dependent people crying out for a vision of survival and salvation. Lament is the language of suffering. Those who live in celebration are concerned with questions of proper management and joyous celebration. Instead of deliverance, they seek constancy and sustainability. The well-off do not expect their faith to begin in a cry, but rather in a song. They do not expect or need intrusion, but they rejoice in stability and the durability of a world and social order that have been beneficial to them. Praise is the language of celebration. Christian communities arising from celebration do not want their lives changed because their lives are in a good place. Tax rates should remain low. Home prices and stocks should continue to rise unabated, while interest rates should remain low to borrow more money to feed a lifestyle to which they have become accustomed. Lament recognizes the struggles of life and cries out for justice against existing injustices. The status quo is not to be celebrated, but instead must be challenged. If tax rates favor the rich, they should be challenged. Redistribution of wealth would not be a catastrophe, but instead a blessing, in contrast to the existing state of economic inequality. The balance in Scripture between praise and lament is lost in the ethos and worldview of American evangelical Christianity, with its dominant language of praise. Any theological reflection that emerges from the suffering have-nots can be minimized in the onslaught of the triumphalism of the haves. What do we lose as a result of this imbalance? American Christians that flourish under the existing system seek to maintain the existing dynamics of inequality and remain in the theology of celebration over and against the theology of suffering. Promoting one perspective over the other, however, diminishes our theological discourse. To only have a theology of celebration at the cost of the theology of suffering is incomplete. The intersection of the two threads provides the opportunity to engage in the fullness of the gospel message. Lament and praise must go hand in hand. Walter Brueggemann asked the question, what happens when appreciation of the lament as a form of speech and faith is lost, as I think it is largely lost in contemporary usage? What happens when the speech forms that redress power distribution have been silenced and eliminated? The answer, I believe, is that a theological monopoly is reinforced. Docility and submissiveness are engendered. and the outcome in terms of social practice is to reinforce and consolidate the political economic monopoly of the status quo. For American evangelicals, riding the fumes of a previous generation's assumptions, a triumphalistic theology of celebration and privilege, rooted in a praise-only narrative, is perpetuated by the absence of lament and the underlying narrative of suffering that informs lament. The loss of lament in the American church reflects a serious theological deficiency. This work attempts to remedy that imbalance by providing commentary on a neglected book of the Bible. The suffering endured by God's people resulting from the fall of Jerusalem provides the backdrop for the poetic struggle offered in Lamentations. Lamentations provides the biblical text and a theological lens through which we examine the themes of urban ministry, justice, and racial reconciliation. We will seek to find contemporary application of the Book of Lamentations within these current themes. Lamentations responds to the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple in 586 BC. This collection of poetic reflections emerges from the rubble of a Jerusalem laid waste by the Babylonians. A multitude of voices are raised by the survivors of the devastation and are brought together in a coherent, unified, corporate lament. In all likelihood, these laments offered by the remnant in Jerusalem were presented in a unified form by one of the few learned survivors of the Babylonian conquest, the prophet Jeremiah, who is attributed authorship of Lamentations in early church tradition. In five chapters, five related but self-contained accounts tell the story of the aftermath of the fall of Jerusalem. In Lamentations 1, we explore the shame of suffering and lament in the context of death. The city of Jerusalem has died, so the first chapter of Lamentations reminds us of the deep pain experienced by the community as a result of this death. How we deal with the reality of shame and death often reveals our relationship with others who suffer. Next, we examine how Lamentations 2 seeks to understand the source of suffering, how we respond to the possibility of God's sovereignty in the midst of suffering reveals our ability to engage in the depth of lament. We also deal with our role as privileged celebrants when we encounter the suffering other. Lamentations 3 reflects on our engagement with a full expression of human suffering, calls us to examine our worship life, and seeks a form of spiritual expression that honors those that suffer. Lamentations 4 reminds us that God deserves all of our respect, while our human achievements merit none of His respect. It reveals how the lament that we offer should reflect our understanding of God at work, even in the midst of suffering. Finally, we examine Lamentations 5 as it calls us to join in a corporate lament prayer. This corporate lament offers the hope that God will provide the answers, even if the answers are not self-evident. The ancient book of Lamentations is not a familiar book to many American Christians. At several points in this commentary, I will offer insight from the genre of lament and the historical context that shed light on the text of Lamentations. While some material may be a review for the listener, visiting the literary and historical context is necessary to the exegesis of the text. Toward that end, some material that may be deemed introductory will be found throughout the body of the text. Despite its age, Lamentations offers us a prophetic critique of what passes for gospel witness in our time. This critique offers fresh insight into our ecclesiology, or more precisely, how the North American Christian community should respond to a broken world. The major themes, the importance of lament, the necessity of engaging with suffering, the power of encountering the other should lead us to a theology of lament that corrects the triumphalism of Christianity in the West. Lamentations may serve as the prophetic corrective necessary to embrace the next phase of Christianity. Lamentations chapter 1. It is a moment very few people forget, the moment your father dies. For most of my life, I had a tumultuous relationship with my father. He abandoned our family when I was young, and understandably, I resented his absence. His departure left us in dire financial straits, and we ended up living in a low-income inner-city neighborhood in Baltimore. My mom took two low-paying jobs to keep our family together, but her long work hours resulted in both my parents being out of the home. Deep-seated animosity built up over the years towards my father. Infrequent and irregular contact with him only fueled my resentment and anger. Then in his 70s, my dad returned home, nearly destitute. He took advantage of the graciousness of my mom, who received him back home. She declared that it was the responsibility of the mature Christians, the rest of the family, to extend grace to the one who had wandered away from the faith. She embodied the story of the gracious father loving the prodigal son. Not long after my father returned to my mom's house, he suffered a major stroke. After several weeks in the hospital, the prognosis was not good, and he was moved from the hospital to hospice, where he would linger for nearly a month. My wife, newborn daughter, and I were living in Massachusetts when my father was incapacitated in Maryland, so I flew down right after the first stroke. That trip resulted in aggravating my animus toward my father. Not only had he returned after years away, but also he had returned just in time to saddle my mom with the medical bills and to further burden his family. I went back to Massachusetts, but returned several weeks later when I was told that he might not have long to live. By this point, my anger had amplified along with his mounting medical bills. I went to his bedside, but did not give thought to the reality of his imminent death. Later that evening, I found myself in the family waiting room listening to my mom and my sisters as they began to talk in detail about the funeral arrangements, an event that would happen in just a few more days. It finally hit me with full force that my dad was really going to die. I left the waiting room, rushed over to my father's room, and kicked out my nieces and nephews. Alone with my dad, I sat by his bed and clasped his hand in mine. Through tears and with a tight grip on his hand, I offered him my complete forgiveness. I asked for his forgiveness for the years of bitterness I had harbored against him. Through his tears and his tightening grip, we were reconciled just hours before his death. The reconciliation that occurred with my father on his deathbed required an important realization on my part. My father was dying, and this could be my last chance to talk to him. Our history, a history of loss and pain, took on an added meaning when I acknowledged the reality of his death. That reality changed the equation. Everything dies eventually. The best and worst of lives come to an earthly end. Kingdoms and empires wax and wane. Cities have their moments in the sun, then fall into disrepair, only to rise up surprisingly from the ashes. Different eras of the church come and go. Local churches are planted and churches shut down. Even churches with impressive buildings made of crystal can declare bankruptcy. Death and its impact cannot be avoided. It must be dealt with. The reality of death and the ongoing cycle of life and death remind us that through it all, Yahweh remains Lord over all. The question is not whether there will be death, but how we will understand and address this reality. In Lamentations 1, we encounter a people who have experienced a great loss. Jerusalem has died, and the reality of this tragic event elicits lament. As the people of God recount their suffering and their painful history, they call out to God in the midst of their shame and ask many of the same questions we ask today. Where is our hope, even in the midst of suffering and death? Can we see God in all circumstances of life? Does our understanding of a historical reality impact our current reality? Does our response to God reflect our understanding of a shameful history and a painful story that must be acknowledged in the face of death? Chapter 1. The Reality of Suffering and Death. The Historical Context of Lamentations. Lamentations does not occur in a vacuum. Historical circumstances shape the unique and specific responses that emerge. The devastating effects of the destruction of Jerusalem in 586 BC serve as the context and impetus for the poetry of Lamentations. Not only does Lamentations address a specific moment in Jewish history, but it also addresses a disaster of catastrophic proportions for God's people. Lamentations chapter 1, verses 1 through 3 offers an overview of Jerusalem's fall. Verse 1 begins with a description of Jerusalem, who once was great among the nations, once so full of people, and queen among the provinces. The once great and prominent status of Jerusalem contrasts with her current state. She is now a slave, a widow, and deserted. In verse 2, we are introduced to her emotions, as bitterly she weeps at night, tears are on her cheeks. Verse 3 summarizes her experience as affliction and harsh labor. The background story that leads to Lamentations culminates with the exile in verse 3. Judah has gone into exile. She dwells among the nations. She finds no resting place. It is noteworthy that Jerusalem is personified as a female. A later section will explore the significance of this personification. Jerusalem finds herself alone, with no one to turn to for help. The city of Jerusalem has moved from being the capital of a great nation to isolation and alienation, with many of her residents sent away into exile. Delbert Hillers notes that the opening cry of Lamentations 1:1 has the effect of an incredulous question. How can it be that? An expression of the speaker's astonishment, grief, or indignation at what has happened. The first three verses of Lamentations remind the community why lament is necessary. A national tragedy has occurred. In verses 1 and 2, Adele Berlin finds that the division into two groups of lines corresponds to the two parallel comparisons between Jerusalem's past and her present. Lamentations 1, verses 1 through 2, presents the contrast between the Jerusalem of a previous era and its current state. This reality, rooted in a historical event, provides the setting for the lament that follows. The fall of a once great city provides the background for the emotional depth in Lamentations. The big picture context for the Book of Lamentations emerges from God's historical relationship to the children of Israel. Under the reigns of David and Solomon, the nation of Israel flourished. After King Solomon's death, two kingdoms emerged: the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. Ultimately, both kingdoms were exiled as punishment for their infidelity and unfaithfulness to their covenant with Yahweh, with the fall of the northern kingdom preceding the fall of the southern kingdom of Judah. Jerusalem, as the capital of Judah, was the final holdout against conquerors from the north, and a long siege ended in its eventual conquest by the Babylonian marauders. The fall of Jerusalem to the Babylonians meant complete devastation to the city and her residents. the Babylonians were ruthless conquerors who followed a scorched earth policy, burning and salting the fields so subsequent crops would be compromised, then proceeding to fill the wells. They destroyed the nation and the land. Particularly upset that Jerusalem had resisted, the Babylonians showed no mercy. As historian John Bright describes, the land had been completely wrecked, its cities destroyed, its economy ruined, its leading citizens killed or deported. The population consisted chiefly of poor peasants considered incapable of making trouble. The remnant of Jerusalem stood in utter dismay at the destruction of their once great city. Jerusalem had measured herself through worldly standards of wealth and prosperity. Now that Jerusalem lay in ruins, those standards were out of reach. The destruction of Jerusalem serves as the apex of suffering for God's people. The last stronghold for a formerly great nation fell, inaugurating the exilic period for God's people. When this tragedy occurs, the people of God tumble to the depth of despair. In Jeremiah 29, we are given a glimpse of two possible responses to the national tragedy of exile. On the one hand, God's people were tempted to withdraw from the world. On the other, they were tempted to return to their idolatrous ways. Lamentations chapter 1, verses 1 through 3 reminds us of the tragic set of circumstances that confronts God's people. They have fallen from the heights. A vibrant city filled with people now lies deserted. A noble queen has now become a slave. Verse 1. How will the people of God respond to this tragedy? Although the proper response to the historical reality of this text is the lament offered in Lamentations, Jeremiah 29 presents two unacceptable options available to God's people sent away into exile. Jeremiah responds to the situation described in Lamentations chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, by sending a letter from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and all the other people Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 1. Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 4 through 7 reveals Yahweh's command for the exiles when they are tempted to withdraw from the world. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. The call in Psalms to seek the peace and prosperity of Jerusalem is turned on its head with the command in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 7, to seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile, that is, Babylon. The familiar formula and the anticipated call to seek the peace of Jerusalem would have been a sign of hope that the exiles could turn their attention back to the promised land. Instead, they are commanded, very unexpectedly, to seek the shalom of Babylon. Yahweh implores his people to continue to live life, even in the midst of shattered dreams and expectations. They are to conduct life in all its fullness, including building homes, planting gardens, getting married, and increasing in number. Even in the midst of a foreign land, they are not to hide from the world, but instead seek ways to engage and even contribute. life continues, even as a community struggles with its place and identity. Escape from the reality of a fallen world is not an option. Jeremiah confronts the desire by a defeated people to give up and run away. The reality of Lamentations chapter 1, verses 1 through 3 should not result in the impulse to escape, but instead should result in engagement. The exiles were disheartened by how far they had fallen, as evidenced by Lamentations chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. God's people were tempted to flee and disengage from the world around them in response to their reality. But Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 4 through 7, challenges God's people to not take that option. Jeremiah's letter to the exiles does not allow for that option. The people of God are to seek the peace of Babylon and not to disengage with a ready-made excuse that Babylon is a wicked city. They are not to give in to the temptation to withdraw from the world when things are not going as they had planned. Jerusalem and American Christianity. In contrast, American Christians have often found themselves in positions of privilege in American society. However, the temptation to withdraw from the world has still presented itself to both 20th and 21st century Christians in the United States. Similar to the self-view of Jerusalem in Lamentations chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, American Christians hold an elevated view of themselves. Into the 20th century, the American church would claim an exceptional status in American society, as well as believing in an exceptional status for the United States. However, challenges to the assumption of exceptionalism in the 20th century would lead to the desire for the church to withdraw from society, similar to the temptation confronting God's people in Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 4 through 7. At the onset of the 20th century, optimism reigned over the possibility of the church's role in society. For much of American history, the Protestant church held the belief in America's role as the city set on a hill, shining the light of Christ to all nations. George Marsden describes the ethos of the American church in the first two decades of the 20th century. Success and progress still seem the dominant mood, underlined by much rhetoric about unity, together with activism, and by beating the drums for the latest crusade. Hope for a Christian century reigned over American Christianity. By the end of the first third of the 20th century, this optimism would be severely compromised. While theological liberals continued to hold a more optimistic view of American society, the fundamentalist stream that helped form evangelicalism moved away from such optimism. Theological conservatives in the middle of the 20th century leaned toward a more pessimistic view of the role of the church in society. Disheartened by a perceived sense of rejection by American society, particularly following the public embarrassment of the Scopes trial, fundamentalists retreated from American society. Dispensational eschatology provided additional fodder for fundamentalist separatism. As Randall Balmer posits, evangelicals suddenly felt their hegemonic hold over American society slipping away. The teeming squalid ghettos, festering with labor unrest, no longer resemble the precincts of Zion that postmillennial evangelicals had envisioned earlier in the century. Faced with this wretchedness, American evangelicals looked to alter their eschatology. Dispensational eschatology, which envisioned the current epoch of world history as only befitting judgment and destruction, fit this worldview. It asserted that the last days of this world could not be redeemed, and that we were simply waiting for the destruction of this world and the institution of the next world. The current world, particularly the urban centers, had become uninhabitable for the good Christian. This increasing pessimism over American cities coincided with the influx of former slaves migrating from the Mississippi Delta to the northern cities, and the increased number of non-Protestant immigrants from southern and eastern Europe. Rapid industrialization and the changing face of the urban landscape resulted in an increasingly negative view of cities and of society. White Protestant flight from the city, therefore, became the solution for those fearful of such change. The negative perception of a changed city aligned with dispensational eschatology. A drastic change from above would be required to stop the flood of secularism and societal decay. With their embrace of dispensationalism, evangelicals shifted their focus radically from social amelioration to individual regeneration. Having diverted their attention from the construction of the millennial realm, evangelicals concentrated on the salvation of souls, and in so doing, neglected reform efforts. An individualistic, soul-saving soteriology emerged from a dispensational theology. Theologically conservative Christians.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.